your course. How many have you have written down the course outcome?
Me has written.
Okay. So course outcome. So example course outcome I show you here. So course outcome, we said that it is a specific, measurable and achievable, and which is a major takeaway by the course from the course by the students. So let's talk about a course called acoustics. So I teach a course on acoustics. So I write down the three course outcome you see in the slides. What I write down? The given the specification of an acoustic room, determine the reverberation time, mean peak path, number of reflection per second group note, and minimum volume for large room acoustics. So if you see that, a outcome has at least two components. One is condition component, what is given. Given the specification of an acoustic room, what student has to perform, determine A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A. Okay. So at least two components. So any outcome has three components. One is called condition component, performance component, and criteria component. Condition component is what is given to the students. Performance component, what they have to perform, and that criteria component up to what level. Suppose I give an example that suppose I writing an outcome for mathematics differential equation. If you write the outcome solve differential equation, it is not achievable because there may be a number of differential equations that is not possible to teach in a 40-hour course. So I cannot cover entire differential equation in a 40-hour course. So I cannot write solve differential equation. I have to write what kind of differential equation, what are the method I will cover in my course. So instead of writing solve differential equation, I can write please solve differential, they will be able to solve differential equation up to second order using this method. Okay, so that way you can make your outcome more specific, more achievable and more measurable. Measurable is very much important. I'll show you some of the course outcome people have written, like that AC DC power management compare. These outcome are measurable. Compare is verb, measurable, but not specific and not achievable. Induction motor operates, solve torque equation of IM. So outcome is not a single line statement. It is a statement which is specific, measurable and achievable. Similarly, to provide student necessary background to analyze processor. It is not outcome, it is not student centric. Every outcome is student centric. It is not what teacher will teach. It is what learner has to learn. Apply the basic concept of electronics. Apply the basic concept of electronics is not in application level. Using basic concept of electronics is okay. What they have to do? That unless that is there, this is not a learner centric outcome. To understand and to identify, understand is not measurable. So I cannot write an outcome using understand action verbs. Similarly, you may say, okay, my course is very introductory course, so I will just introduce the students about this subject. But if it is BTEC level course, and you said the big data analysis is my course, and I said, okay, define big data is one of the outcome. It is not. It cannot be a course outcome. It may be one of the lecture outcome, but cannot be a course outcome. So whatever the course, if your outcome cognitive level is knowledge and comprehension, then it cannot be an outcome of a course for BTEC engineering or more than BTEC engineering course. Explain the basic architecture of 80085. Explain is knowledge level. So it cannot be a course outcome. It can be a lecture outcome or can be a module outcome, not course outcome. Similarly, cognitive level, apply basic law of EMLF. This apply is not application level. Apply Newton's second law of motion is not application level. You have to say that compute force for a given mass and acceleration using Newton's second law of motion is an application level outcome. Not apply basic law of EMLF or not apply basic law of Newton's law is outcome of any course. Then not specific. That there is some English term like different, such as, like, basic, all are non-specific word in English. So none of the outcomes should contain those words. You cannot write compute different parameters. The different, you may say different means 1 and 2. Somebody say different means 1, 3, 4, 5. For example, suppose you write a question, you give a question in the exam, write the difference between A and B, and some student write single difference, and some student write 5 difference, and other student write 10 difference. Who will got the highest marks? You may say, okay, who has write the 10 difference? But the student who has write the single difference, he can challenge you, sir, you have said that write the difference between A and B. How many difference you never said me? So that's why the different word is non-specific. Like, such as, various, all those words are non-specific. So those words cannot be part of your any outcome. So do not write an outcome using those words. You may say, oh, this is, write the basic principle of this. Something is basic to you, maybe advanced to me. Something is basic to you, maybe pre-basic to me. So basic, word basic is a vague term. So you cannot write basic in the term of, in any one of the outcome. Similarly, there is an outcome which is not achievable. It creates hardware modeling and design tool. What hardware modeling? Hardware modeling can take entire lifetime. So how much hardware modeling you will cover in your course has to be there. Unless it is there, you cannot say that outcome is achievable. So every course outcome must be specific, measurable, and achievable within your course. Determine the use of plant conservation. It's not. It cannot be. It is a very huge subject. So open-ended, any outcome is not achievable. Like I can give an example, use different numerical method for solution of first order, second order, ordinary differential equation. I just realized that outcome in a new way in that below. Use numerical method for solve first order and second order, ordinary differential equation. Different numerical method I have omitted. Once I say numerical methods, means all numerical methods will be covered in my course. If I cover only A, B numerical method, then I should write, use numerical method A and B to solve first order and second order ordinary differential equation. Is clear? So that way you have to write down the outcome. Unless you write down the outcome that way, you cannot map the outcome with PO. So that is called COPO mapping. So let's, this is my course. This is called course matrix. Mapping between CO and PO is called course matrix. So 1 to 12 is my PO. I can write down 1 or 2 PSO outside of this. So maybe my course is not touching the PSO. That's why I am not writing down the PSO. So let's write down the only PO. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is domain specific. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 are domain independent. So now I have written down this is my CO. So given the specification of an acoustic room is my CO. So what is the action verb? Determine. If the action verb is determine, what is the cognitive skill of this CO? Cognitive skill is analysis. So what Ushad said, we should define that if the CO is directly mapped with the PO, then I put weight vector 3. If CO is slightly matched with, indirectly matched with PO, I put out vector 2. If it is slightly matched with PO, I put out vector 1, weight vector 1. So now, if you see, the determine this PCO is analysis level, so which is completely matched with PO 2. What PO 2 said? The student will be able to analyze. So analysis level, so I can say the CO 1 is 100% matched with PO 2. That's why I put weight vector 3 here. And CO1, when they learn how to analyze, they should learn how to solve also. That's why I put weight vector 2, because PO1 is said they should be able to solve engineering problem. So 2 and 3 I put weight vector here. Similarly, if I say given the specification of auditorium, list is knowledge level, design is synthesis level. So which PO is synthesis level? PO3. They should be able to design process or part of a process. So since it is design level, so CO2 is directly matched with PO3. So I put weight vector 3. when they learn design, they should learn analyzing and solving ability, but they are indirect mapping. That's why I put one and two weight vector in here. So that way I can define my course matrix. Now come to the domain independent PO. So I am saying that domain independent PO are achievable by two ways. One is either you can offer an interdisciplinary course which is very specific to particular domain independent PO, like project management and finance. I cannot say that while I am teaching acoustics, I will talk about the project management and finance. So for that, in domain independent PO may require an interdisciplinary courses. But rest of the PO, like communication skill, ethics, individual and teamwork, lifelong learning, those can be tackled while I am teaching a domain independent course. So while I am developing their acoustics, the design ability in acoustic domain, I am claiming that I am developing their communication skill, maybe their teamwork, their lifelong learning, their ethics. So I put 1, 1, 1 there so that it is slightly matched. It is not directly related to those PO, but I saying that due to my teaching learning process, which I said that I have already designed this outcome-based curricula, give it to the students, they will try to solve the problem which is given in the curriculum. So I am encouraging self-learning ability. So I can say that my course is matching with lifelong learning with weight vector 1. I am allowing interaction in the class. So I am developing communication skill. So I can say my course is matching with communication skill by weight vector 1. So this way you can develop your course matrix. Once your course matrix is developed, then you can go for the program matrix development. In program matrix development, what I say, that instead of individual course outcome, here I will put that as a course, EE300-300-11 is a course which I have developed in course matrix. So from there, either I can take the average. So if you see the PO1, 2 plus 2 plus 1, it is 5. And if it is fully matched, it will be 3 plus 3 plus 3, 9. So I can say the average weight of my course to PO1 is 5 by 9. Average weight of PO2 is 8 by 9. So either you can put 0, which are not related, or you can put dash. If you put dash, then the average will change. If you put that, then it will not contribute to the average. So it will be 4 by 6. So if you, based on this principle, you can define your program matrix that I will put weight vector 3 here if it is above 80% matching, if I put that. Now if I put 0 there, since it is average is low down, as a teacher I can say, if the average score of a particular PO for my course is more than 70%, then I put weight vector 3. If the average score is below 70% and up to 30%, I'll put weight vector 2. If it is below 30%, I'll put weight vector 1. If doesn't match, I'll put 0 or dash. So that way I can develop the entire course matrix. So if you see, the PO2 is matching by 8 by 9. So it is more than 70%. That's why I put weight vector 3 here. EE300-11, I put weight vector 3. Similarly, 5 by 9, it is below 70% but above 30%, I put weight vector 2. So before developing the course matrix and program matrix, your developing procedure must be elaborately mentioned. I'm saying the development, the course matrix, I'm saying if a CO is directly related with the PO, I put weight vector 3. If it is partially related, 2. If it is slightly related, 1. If it is not related, I put 0. So based on the individual course matrix, I can develop the program matrix considering each and every course matrix. Is clear? Any questions on COPO mapping? Any questions on COPO mapping, participant?
Sir, you said that the 1, 2, 3 can be marked as per our convenience, like you said that more than 80% can be set 3, then from 30 to 70% it can be set 2. So it can be different for different courses, or it needs to be decided at the department level?
It is based on the how you define your average. If you, when you, during the course matrix, if you put 0, where your CO is not related to the PO, that means your average will be coming down. So that's why you can say 70% is sufficient. But if you put dash, that means not the don't care element, you can say, or you are not caring that that weightage, then your average will be a little bit of higher side. So in that case, your threshold has to be shifted. So based on that, you have to decide it.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so it is teacher's perception. It is not directly, you can say exactly you can measure. But yes, I can exactly measure that CO between the PO. If you write down a CO, the student will able to explain this thing, then you cannot match any one of the PO. None of the PO said that they should able to explain his sufficient condition for PO. Explaining is necessary. But if that is not course outcome, that can be a unit or module outcome. So if you see that all PO is started from application level, analysis level, synthesis level, evaluation level. None of the PO is started from, you can say, that knowledge and comprehension level. Knowledge and comprehension is necessary, but that is not the sufficient condition. Those are the necessary conditions. So when you write down your course outcome, if your course outcome doesn't match, you cannot develop the course matrix.
Yes.
Clear? Now I come to the attainment calculation. How many have already know the attainment calculation? Anybody else? Anybody know the attainment calculation? Since it is not interactive, one-way lecture is written.
We are doing this program outcome calculation and CO outcome calculation.
Okay. So now what is attainment? Attainment is nothing but a, you can say that when I define the assessment and evaluation, what I said, the assessment is a process to find out the evidence about the student's competence. Competence means attainment, whether they attain the particular course goal or not. So that is called attainment. So how do you calculate the attainment? Attainment calculation can be done in two ways. One is called direct, another one is called indirect. So what to attain? As a course, so attainment calculation is course-wise, not exactly program-wise. You cannot say that I have directly calculated the attainment of PO. You have to calculate the attainment of CO. Then you can come to the attainment of PO. So unless you calculate the attainment of CO, you cannot compute the attainment of PO. So how can you done? You can do two ways. One is called direct method, another is called indirect method. What is direct method say? Direct method means you are directly measuring the attainment of the course goal by the students. So I can say the assessment method by which I am collecting data is direct. That means it is collected from the student's objective. And indirect method, it is a survey based. It is subjective opinion about the attainment of the CO of the students. So again, it is can two types. One is called objective, another one is called subjective. So in objective, what we are saying? So objective, we are saying the assessment method you have to define first before I start to calculate the course outcome attainment. So what are the assessment method? So assessment method are the process to collecting evidence about the student's competence. So the assessment methods are semester exam, assignment, lab assignment, project, seminar, viva. I purposefully not included the class test, because purpose of the class test or any periodic assessment is not part of an evaluation. So if it is not part of an evaluation, I cannot include it in part of an attainment calculation. So what I said, that all the assessment methods which are related to my evaluation are part of attainment calculation. So semester exam, assignment, lab assignment, project, seminar, viva, all are attainment calculation, can be part assessment process for attainment calculation. First step of attainment calculation is called mapping. Mapping between your CO and assessment method. So what is mapping? So mapping is nothing but it is a relationship between your assessment method and your course outcome. Suppose this is my course. Course name is Acoustic Design. C201 is the code. LPT I have divided. I credit is 4. And this is my course outcome. CO1, CO2, CO3, CO4. CO1 is analysis level. CO2 is design level. CO3 is analysis level. CO4 is simulation level. But it required a software, so it covers the modern tools and uses also. Is clear? So now this is my CO. Now I say I am defining my vector or evaluation rubrics. What is the evaluation rubrics? Let's say I said mid semester evaluation is 30 marks, end semester evaluation is for 40 marks, and assignment is for 20 marks. Why I included assignment here? Because there is a one outcome in my course which I cannot assess using time-bounded proctored exam. Proctored exam means the exam which will be invalidated by a guard, and it will be time-bounded exam. So I cannot evaluate whether the students will able to simulate an acoustic design of an auditorium. I cannot test it using a 3-hour auditory or 3-hour classroom test. So what I said, that CO4 can be assessed using assignment. I will provide assignment to the students. They will solve the assignment, and based on the solution of the assignment, I will judge whether the student has attained the CO4 or not. So evaluation rubrics I have defined 30, 50 and 20. Now I am defining the mapping. So let's say in mid-semester, maybe in your case internal exam, external exam and assignment. So let's mid-semester, I have given 3 questions, question number 1, 2 and 3. And I am saying in mid-semester, I am testing only CO1 and part of CO2. So the question number 1 carrying 10 marks related to CO1, question number 2 carrying 10 marks related to CO1, and question number 3 carrying 10 marks related to CO2. Is clear? So once you design the question paper and design your weight vector, you can map the questions or test item with your CO. So I am saying that mid semester I will take question number 1, 2, 3 for only testing CO1 and part of a CO2. In end semester, I designed 5 questions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and one question number 1 and 2 and 3 related to the CO2, and question number 3, 4 and 5 is related to the CO3. So a single question can be scattered to multiple outcomes, doesn't matter. So I have that example I have given here. A single problem or test item can be scattered to multiple course outcome. Is possible. So I am saying the question number 3 is scattered to outcome number 3 and 2 both. And question number 1 in end semester only scattered to CO2, 2 is CO2, 3 is also CO2. And I have taken assignment. Because I have a CO4 which can be tested by assignment, that's why I designed 2 assignments, each are carrying 10 marks, assignment 1 and assignment 2. and both are related to the CO4. I do not have a lab this course, so the lab is not matching. If I have a lab, lab also matching, every lab also have a CO. So I write down the lab CO, then you write down the, you can say the lab report carrying 10 marks, conducting the lab, design of experiment carrying 20 marks. So those weight vectors will be defined and you test the student based on those targets. Okay, so your assignment has to be designed based on those targets. So you can give them the component and told them, design this experiment to measure the unknown resistance. So they will design the experiment and measure the unknown resistance. Okay, say, you say design of experiment carry 20 marks. So if they are able to do it, so they will get 20 marks. Okay, so those data is required for calculating attainment. Now I am defining the logic of attainment. I am saying, you are saying, no, some of the university has answered any 5 questions or answered any 5 questions out of 8 questions, okay? So out of 8 questions, answer any 5. So what is the requirement? I have to design 5 questions such a way that any 5 they choose, they have to cover entire syllabus. Similarly, I am saying, I am designing 2 questions for CO1, question number 1 and 2. Maybe question number 1 is minimum requirement of my course. And question number 2 is little bit of complex. Because in a class, I have to judge 2 things. One is whether they achieve the minimum requirement or they have achieved the higher the minimum requirement also. So I can design the question such a way that I said the question number 1 only for testing whether they attained the minimum requirement or not. So cognitive level of the question number 1 and question number 2 is same. Only difference is complexity of the question. So the complexity of the question is question number 2 is little bit of high. And complexity of the question number 1 is little bit of less. So I am saying, if all students are able to solve question number 1, then also they achieve the outcome. So I am guaranteed, if a student is able to answer question number 1, they have achieved the outcome 1. So I can say, in a question number 1, so in a mid-sem, if the CO1 is attained fully, if a student score greater than 50%. So out of 2 questions, if they score 50%, then I can say that my CO1 is fully attained. And CO2 is attained fully, if I can say, I can design CO2 such a way that the out of 4 questions, if they are able to solve 2 questions, then they attain CO2. So I can define attainment matrix or attainment weight that if it is greater than 50%, CO1 is fully attained. So attainment weight is 3. If it is between 30 to 50%, I said weight vector 2. If it is less than 30%, I said weight vector 1. Okay, so this is the mapping part between the question paper and CO. That's why I'm saying, unless you map your questions with the CO, you cannot calculate the attainment. Once you've done that, then you can say, suppose I want to calculate the attainment of CO2. Okay, so I'm calculating attainment of CO2. I have a 70 students in my class. Okay. So question number assessment 1, mid-sem question 3, end-sem question 1, 2, 3 are carrying the attainment of CO2. So I write down that and max score is 40. So if it is student score 40 out of this 40, 1, 2, 3 and question number 3 of mid-sem, then he has attained fully 100%. So I said, student number 1, out of these 4 questions, got 32. Okay, if got 32, since it is 80%, more than 50%, I assigned weight vector 3 for attainment. And I can say the student number one is attained the CO2. Similarly, students two, I can say that it is three, above 50%. So question of student three also attained the CO2. But student three is 50%. So I can say he is not attained the CO2 and the attainment weight is one. So student number 70 may got 45%. So I put void vector 2 and not attend. Okay. So out of 70 students, let if 60 student is attend the goal, then I can say CO2 is attend fully. None of the system can produce 100% efficiency. So if I have a 70 student class, there may be a 7 or 6 student will fail to attend the CO2. But I cannot consider that failure is a failure of attainment of CO2. So if I say, university says that if 90% students attend the course goal, that means course goal is attained. Okay? So course goal is attained. How to calculate the PO attainment? Then I have to calculate the average attainment weight of my course. So for CO2, I can calculate the average attainment weight, 3 plus 1 plus like that divided by 70. So average attainment weight is 2.8. Now I go for all CO. So CO1, CO2, CO3, CO4, I can calculate percentage of the student's attainment. And I can write down whether the student has attained the goal or not. So if the CO3 attainment percentage is 45%, then I say no, this CO3 is not attended. Then to calculate the PO attainment, I require course matrix. So this is the course matrix which I have already developed. Now this is my whole matrix, including the course matrix. So PO 1 to PO 12 is my course matrix. Attainment, yes, yes, no, yes, is attainment indication. And this is the average attainment weight, 2.7 for CO 1. So I am calculating like CO 2, it is 2.8. I can calculate for CO 1, that is 2.7, CO 3, 1.2, CO 4, 2.6. Now I want to calculate the attainment of PO based on this data. So what is the attainment of PO? The attainment of PO is nothing but a multiplication of 2.7 with weight vector 2 plus 2.8 with weight vector 1 plus 1.2 multiplied by 2 plus 2.6 multiplied by 1. So I can say it is nothing but a sum of product of column 3 and column 5 divided by sum of the column 5. Then I get attainment weight is 2.2. So I can say the PO1 C201 is my course number. So C201 I have written down. Just a minute. So C201 is my attainment course, my course number is C201, C201. So now I write down for C201, the attainment of PO1 is 2.2, attainment of PO2 is 2.21, attainment of PO3 is 2.72. That way I can calculate the attainment of PO for course C201. Similarly, for course C101, I can calculate. So all from all courses, I can calculate the attainment and I can develop the attainment matrix of the program matrix. Is clear? Is clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This is clear? So
yes,
now,
sir.
If you correlate your evaluation sheet, I have given that attainment calculation for some questions. You can able to answer those questions. I think so. So this is a very clear-cut method. There is no ambiguity. First requirement is that your mapping between the assessment and CO. assessment test item and CO. So if your course has 10 questions, it doesn't matter whether it is 3 questions, you can make 10 questions in mid-semester. But you have to map 10 questions with the CO. And you map how much question is necessary to say that student is attained the CO1. Because there is a two dimension of a CO. One dimension is the cognitive level, another dimension is the complexity. Your cognitive level you cannot compromise. By complexity you can say that since I have a tier 2 college, I am not producing the researcher who will take the research, so my complexity of the problem may be slow, may be low. So that doesn't matter. You can define the low complexity problem and you can say if the students attend this much is sufficient. Then you can calculate the attainment. But you cannot say that I have a tier 2 institute, that's why my student only know how the AC machine work, not how to design the AC machine. Then it is not acceptable. So this way you have to think and you have to develop your attainment matrix, which is called direct attainment calculation. Is clear?
Yes, sir.
Up to sir, this, any questions from any participant?
Yes, sir, I am having.
Okay, go ahead.
Sir, in the question mapping with the CO, you said that one question can be mapped with two COs.
Yes.
Yes, sir. This is
you define a question which is two parts, part A and part B. So part A may be related to the CO1 and part B may be related to the CO2.
Yes, sir. So the weightage of question number 3 for the CO2 shall be 5, because if I am assuming that both the questions are
final mapping, you can do that. Weightage is 5. You can do the final mapping like that way, or unless you can say I am just taking that on average, in average it will be not that much of matter. But you can final mapping, you can, yes, you can. Suppose your weight vector is 10, you can say the CO1 is 5 and CO2 is 5, or CO1 is 3 and CO3 is 7. That way also you can go.
Okay.
So instead of writing Q3 10, you can write 3 plus 7.
Okay, yes.
3 plus 7 is equal to 10. For example, in this acoustic design, suppose I told them that to design the acoustic part of this auditorium, this is the physical dimension is given, and determine the reverberation time. See, the determine the reverberation time is part of CO1.
Yes.
And design is part of CO2. So I can say that question number 3 is mapping with the two CO. It is CO1 and CO2.
Yes, sir.
Any other participant have any questions?
Sir, I am having one more, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
Sir, in the PO attainment matrix, where the final attainment of the courses is written against the PO.
Yes. Okay.
So,
what is your question?
Sir, just show that table so that I can explain you the question. My question is basically, suppose PO1, it is mapping with the course with the PO. It is basically CO with the POs. It is course with the PO.
Okay.
For every CO,
you calculate the attainment. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So for every CO, you calculate the attainment. Now, what I'm saying, the average attainment of PO1, if you see the below written line, the attainment of PO1 by the course C201 is nothing but a attainment rate of CO1 multiplied by the attainment vector of CO1 plus attainment rate of CO2 multiplied by the attainment vector of PO1. Attainment weight of 1.2 multiplied by the PO1 weight vector 2 and 2.6 multiplied by 1. All are summed together and divided by
all the weights.
1 plus 2 plus 1. Average weight, total weight of that your course towards PO1.
it is weighted average. Sir, in the next slide, I am having question.
Next slide, I just write down the actual attainment.
Yes, sir. Sir, now here, we have mentioned that course 201 is having score of 2.2, which is basically substantial, that is high.
You can write down that instead of 2.2, then when you write down, instead of write, you can write down using whole number also. So you can say if it is above 2, then I put 3. But instead of doing that, I think you just actual number will be much, much better sounding. So don't think this one. This I one you should know.
Sir, now when I would be calculating the PO assessment, which is made at the end of 4 years of study for a student. So at the end of 4 years of study, suppose I say that a student has undergone, suppose, 90 courses.
90 courses,
yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So for all those 90 courses, this table is completed with respective attainment. So now when I will be calculating the PO attainment, PO1 attainment, suppose. Sir, then PO1 attainment for all the courses.
So you can take the average.
Weighted average or average?
Average. It seems the all field will be the data. So you just add that all data and divide it by the number of courses.
But here the question is, all the POs are not related to the all the courses are not related to the POs with the same weights. Suppose I am taking here in the PO8. So with the PO8, the course 201 was having lesser relation.
No, but if attainment is 2.7. Relation is lesser, but attainment is 2.7 because this when you calculate the PO, suppose that PO12, so 2.7 multiplied by 1. 2.8 multiply by 1, 1.2 multiply by 1, and 2.6 multiply by 1 divided by 5. So that means your attainment of your 12 is 2.7. Attainment is different. Attainment means, are you say that the students are developing the lifelong learning? Yes, I can say 2.7% is my confidence they are developing lifelong learning. Attainment is not that whether they are, so I am saying the achievement, whether they have achieved it or not. If it is close to 3, what is the meaning? The meaning is that the students are developed that skill. If it is close to 2, the meaning is that student has developed that skill but not that capacity. If it is below 2, you can say the student 50%. You can say the attainment, 50% of the students have developed that skill. So that's why there is good another data is there. If you see percentage data, attainment yes or no.
This is
required for augmentation of your course. Suppose you teach a course and you find out that out of 4 CO, 3 CO are not attended by the students. What feedback as a teacher you can say, take? The feedback is that the teaching learning process for that course is not correct. So you have to change the teaching learning process so that maximum number of students can attend the course. So this table is important for teaching purpose.
Yes.
And this table is important for your average attainment calculation to find out the bigger picture on the course, on the program. So the bigger picture on the program.
Yes, sir.
Clear? Any questions from other participants?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Any questions from other participants? Anybody else want to say anything?
Participants can unmute themselves and their questions before, sir. Sir, here one question is in the chat box.
Okay. The percentage is
80%. Yes, sir.
The percentage 80% and other can vary for different subjects. That is not very, as a department, when you design this thing for a particular program, so your success has to be earmarked. Your department can say, for this year, See, this year we are implementing, if 70% student is achieved, then it is very good for us, okay, 70%. Then you can say, if 70% student is attained, we have done the job. But next year you can say, we shifted this threshold to 80%. The 80% students will achieve this. Then you can say, okay, it is improving. But you cannot say the 100% students will be achieved. It is not possible. None of the system can give you 100% efficiency. So there will be some students who will be not achieve it. Clear?
Yes, sir.
That is why we need to map all indirect PO. No, not all the indirect PO. I am saying that this is the challenge to the teacher. While you are teaching a subject, can you say that not only you are developing domain-dependent outcome, but also you are developing domain-independent outcome which is required? So I can say, while I am teaching an acoustic theory, I can definitely say that yes, I can develop their communication skill, I can develop their ethics, I can develop their self-learning ability, I can develop their teamwork. But I cannot say I will develop their project management and finance ability. That is not possible. But suppose I am teaching a course on software engineering, then I can say definitely I will teach them their software. If I teach them the software engineering, definitely I can say yes, I will touch the project management and finance. Because that is also part of my software engineering. So that is important. That's why people are saying, that don't go to the class and deliver your information in the class.
Yes.
Have you talked to the students with the ethical issues? Not I am saying that you are discussing what is the fundamental rights of Indian people or the fundamental rights of the world. Not like that. Related to a subject, can you tell a story, ethical story related to your subject to the student? So that will develop the ethics. So that way you can do it. Not that all domain independent PO will be touched. Some definitely you can touch, some definitely you cannot for every course. But suppose you are teaching a course on chemical process engineering. Definitely you touch the environment and sustainability. So if that's why the BTech course is not a single course. Different courses are there. And some of the PO definitely cannot be covered by the domain dependent courses that require a multidisciplinary subject. Like project management and finance, most of the time we can say the one course on business administration will be there for every BTech students. So those are called interdisciplinary courses. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Now I go for indirect attainment, okay?
Yes, sir.
So indirect attainment. So direct attainment assessment methods you have defined. Similarly, indirect attainment. Attainment also, there is some assessment method. I can collect feedback from alumni. The feedback collected from of the alumni students. So collect feedback and suggestion about the program satisfaction with respect to program outcome. I can collect the feedback in two ways. Either I can ask the alumni that out of this program outcome, in your opinion, which you have achieved during your course of study in this institute. Or I can ask course by course. Course by course is impossible from alumni. Because you cannot, a BTech course may have around 5 into 8, 40 or 60 courses. You can say 80 courses. So if there is 80 courses, I cannot collect feedback for 80 courses from each and every alumni. Okay, one thing I never mentioned, that is very important thing. You have to calculate the attainment for a batch, not for a year. Because batch is your product, not year is your product.
Yes, sir.
So suppose there is a 98 batch, that means their first year, second year, third year, fourth year. Not amalgamate with the 98 first year, 99 second year, not like that. So your attainment, direct attainment has to be calculated batch wise, because every batch is your product, not every year is your product. Is clear? So now come to similarly here also, you can collect the feedback for alumni batch wise. 98 pass out, 2000 pass out alumni. So you can collect batch wise. So if you collect the feedback and suggestion batch wise on the program outcome, not course outcome, because course outcome will be better, but you cannot do it. So, but you can do it if you are able to do it. Similarly, exit survey. Exit survey means your fourth year students, when they pass out from your college, or suppose in case of M.Tech, in the second year students, when they pass out from your institute or your department, you can ask the attainment of CO and PO, both. You can give them 12 PO and told them to write down the attainment, and you can generate a course-wise template and told them to give the feedback. It is possible. Even you can distribute the, suppose you have 100 and 200 students, you can distribute it for different courses. Because if it is sample size is very large, you can take a random sampling, that is also work. So it is not necessary that every student has to give a feedback for every courses. So some group of students give a feedback from some courses, some, but those group will be randomly selected. So the bias data will be there, not there. I think there may be some data analytic person may be there with you, he can design that experiment. But exit survey means the survey from your fourth year students. Then employer feedback. Feedback collected from an employer about your attainment. So you can collect, suppose you said I have taught a course about the data structure and algorithm. And so one of my PSO is that they will be very good in development of application software, for this kind of application software for a small scale industry. Now you ask your employer, are you feel that my students are able to cope up with application software development? So when you give the questionnaire, you are not giving the questionnaire directly the PO. You are giving a questionnaire which is designed based on the PO. Again, the questionnaire will map with the PO. So you can say that PO1 related 2 questions, PO2 related 3 questions. So those are called survey questions. How to design the survey questions? Either you can use MOS scale, that mean opinion scale, that means out of 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, good, very good, excellent, average. So you can design 5 level. Out of 1 to 5, they have to score. So once you collected the feedback, either course-wise or program-wise, suppose you collected the feedback course-wise, then suppose you have collected the feedback from 70 students of a course C201, and out, let's in 3-point scale, I have designed here 3-point scale, good, very good, excellent, or you can use 5-point scale also. So if it is 3-point scale, out of 70 students, 7 students score 1. Opinion is level 1. Opinion is level 2 of 33 students. Opinion in level 3 is 30 students. So total score is 163. What is the average weight? 163 divided by 70 into 3. Because if all are good, then my score should be 70 into 3, 210. So I calculate average attainment weight. Instead of examination data, I am calculating based on their opinion poll data. Is clear? Again, I can calculate the average attainment weight of the CO1, CO2, CO3, CO4. Then again, I can do the same process which I follow in direct attainment. Just column 3 multiplied by with the column 5 divided by the weight of the column 5. Same thing I can do. Is clear? So I can course wise I can calculate attainment. Similarly, I can calculate attainment PO wise. So I collect the feedback for 70 student PO wise. So the reply is again 7, 7, 33, 30. So I can say the average attainment of the PO1 is 2.32. So again, I can calculate an attainment matrix for indirect attainment. Is clear? So this is the process for calculating attainment of a student's indirect, this is called indirect attainment. Any questions?
No, sir.
Indirect attainment is very clear. So now I can assume that all of you can calculate the attainment correct way and you can explain it, not that there is a vague idea. It is a very systematic process and you can explain it to the MBA team or whatever.
Sir, I am having one more query here. When we are collecting the data from the different survey, so how to assign the weight to those survey for the POs?
Okay, so suppose your scale is, let's say you are collecting data in 5-point scale. That means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So maximum weightage is 5 and minimum is 1. So I asked somebody that what is the attainment level of PO1, he said 4. So now that way, suppose you collected the data from 70 people, that I have explained. But yes, if you say that your PO is distributed, that means instead of 70 people, let my course is collected data from 30 people. Then I can calculate the 30 people average attainment. So it is called MOS score. Average MOS score of your CO or of your PO. If you collected CO wise, you can collect CO wise. If you collect PO wise, you can collect PO wise. You may say, I have a 200 students in fourth year. So 200 students in fourth year, instead of collecting data from every student for every courses, I can say out of 200 students, I will collect that data for 10 courses of 20 students, another 10 courses for another 20 students, another 10 courses for another 20 students. But the selection of the student will be completely random. Then also you can calculate average attainment of your CO and then you can calculate the PO. Okay?
Yes.
Any questions?
Ms. Deepa Modi, she is asking how total score is calculated. I think question is not complete.
How total score is calculated? I have shown you that how the individual attainment of PO 1, 2, 3 is calculated. Now for every course, you can develop a course matrix for that attainment. So suppose this is for course number C201. So you can calculate the, you can develop the course matrix for CO and another course also. Like this way, this is the CO201 attainment, same thing, whether it is direct or indirect, procedure is same, only the assessment method will be changed. Assessment method in case of direct, it is examination, and in case of indirect, it is survey only.
Yes. Sir, one more query is in chat box. How do we answer this, that none of my student pass GATE examination?
That you cannot answer. The GATE examination, you can say that if you see that, if GATE examination is related to your teaching learning process, it is not. GATE, you can, your answer should be very clear that if my course outcome is attained by the students, that means they have the skill. If they have the skill, they should answer the GATE question also. But if the GATE question is something else, which is not related to the subject, then student cannot answer. So is your course is related to the GATE syllabus or not? First you have to decide. If it is GATE syllabus, then what kind of skill GATE want? Are those skills covered in your course? That is very important. So when you design your course, that's why when you design your syllabus, suppose you design your syllabus and something is designed which is not included in the GATE. So that syllabus is obsolete. means it is unfortunate that we are saying for the giving a GATE exam there is another coaching is required. Then why they study for BTech engineering? If they are not able to enter from BTech engineering study, then that they have not studied that BTech engineering. This is unfortunate. So that is the important issue. That can I improve the quality of my teaching so that they should success in all aspects of life, not only GATE. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Anything else?
Thank you.
Unless I can go for some 10 minutes on attributes.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I just opening the PPT. This is called teaching attribute. How do you teach good? That means, how do you become a good teacher? I think all of you can say that are the good teacher is by one or by practices? Any answer? Are you think the good teacher is by one or by practices?
Both, sir. You are by born.
Why born? If it is why born, then you cannot do anything for good teaching.
No, no, both. I said both. Few are by born also, and it can definitely be practiced.
Yes. So the purpose of this experiment was very simple. They tried that suppose you said that everybody knows that there is some good teacher. Even if all of you, if you close your eyes and remember, you can remember one name in your life that who is a good teacher for you. Everybody's life it is there. So now, if I say that somebody is a good teacher, then my objective is that, can I produce good teachers? I'm saying that what that teacher is doing in the class to become a good teacher. If I am a teacher, if I practice those phenomena, am I not become a good teacher? So the whole thing is very, very, you can say the experimental. Can I define certain parameter or can I identify certain activity which a teacher is doing in the class? A good teacher doing in the class. And if I follow the same activity, can I become a good teacher? Or rather, I define the problem in other manner. All of the colleges, there is called teaching feedback. I think so. You also have. You have teaching feedback?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So if I ask you, what is the purpose for that teaching feedback form?
Purpose is to strengthen the teaching learning by giving the proper feedback to the teacher.
What teaching learning? That means
the teacher can improve on its performance.
Okay, so that means you are saying that most of the time what we say from here, your score is 3.4, your score is 3.5, you improve your score. This is a vague statement.
No.
So that means, what should I do in my class so that my teaching score improve? Can I give that feedback? So this is the process. This is the research work. You can see there is a two book name I will show you. There is two book. You can write down this book name or I send you the slide. You can get this two book name. You can read this book. It's called Collaborative Teaching and Learning in Higher Education. So they are very simple. That first you define what is good teaching. Most of us define good teaching in two ways. I'm not showing the slide because slides written something. Same thing is written what I'm saying. So most of us define teaching good teacher in two way. One is that if you remember for your kid, oh, that teacher last batch, he had a 20 batch students, out of 20, 18 are crack IIT JEE. So that teacher is a good teacher. Oh, under this teacher, last batch there is a 20 students, 19 students score 98% in class 10 plus 2 exam. So that teacher is a good teacher. That means the teacher is a good teacher by students' performance. Since students are perform good, that's why you declare the teacher is a good teacher. But that is not only the good teaching criteria. If you close your eyes, you can remember a teacher who is not teach for score, who is inspiring, who is motivated you to learn. So another way to define good teacher is the teacher where the student's aspiration is very high. Most of the students say this teacher is excellent teacher. It is not that all the students on that teacher's class score high score, but he or she is an excellent teacher by students' aspiration. Then they design, let's design an experiment that suppose a teacher said, I am a good teacher by student achievement, when student performance. Then I define some instructional dimension, some parameter. Means I said this teacher, last batch out of 20 students, 19 crack IIT JEE. Okay, so it is defined that this teacher is a good teacher. Now I want to see what that teacher is to. Defining certain dimensions. Of that teacher is dancing in the class, singing in the class, what he or she is doing. So what they said? They define that a teacher's activity in certain dimensions. That is called instructional dimension. Are the teacher course is well organized? Are the teacher presentation is clear or clarity? Are the perceived outcome of interest in instruction, simulation of interest in a course or subject, encouragement of question and discussion, teacher enthusiasm in the subject? So that is called high inference teaching behavior. Those are called high inference teaching behavior. That means what the teacher is doing in the class. So this is called high inference teaching behavior. So what they've done a simple experiment. They collect the feedback from the students on the high inference teaching behavior. There is a 40 high inference teaching behavior they have defined. Out of 40, 11 are very important. You can see that book and collect those 11. 11 are very important. Then what they do, out of those 11, they collect a assessment feedback from the students that you said, so this is the your teacher, you score the clarity in out of 5. So the student said 4, some student said 3, some student said 5 out of 5. Then I correlate those data with the student result. And I find out which is the highest correlation. So if I do that, they find out that if you want to increase the student achievement, then course organization is a very important factor. That means your course must be well organized. Clarity in presentation is factor number 2. Perceived outcome of interest, factor number 3. Simulation of interest, factor number 4. Encouragement of question and discussion class, factor number 5. Teacher enthusiasm in the subject, factor number 11. So that way they find out the importance factor to improve the student achievement. Similarly, when they done the same experiment for for overall teacher readiness, students' aspirations, then the importance is changed. Then course organization is not number one parameter. Clarity is not number one parameter. So clarity is number two, here also number two. Outcome number three, but simulation of interest become number one parameter. So in your institute, when you collect the feedback in high importance teaching behavior, what do you want to collect? You do not want to collect this teacher is 5-point scale, this teacher is 4-point, this teacher is 3.8, not like that. You want to collect out of this dimension. You may select out of 40, you may select this 12 dimension, will set. So out of this 12 dimension, how many teacher is, what is their course in each dimension? So if my clarity of presentation out of 5, I get 2, that means definitely I have to improve my clarity of presentation. In course organization out of 5, if I get 2, then I have to improve my course organization. So from feedback, I get this only. Now, how do we improve my course organization? Very important. How do you improve your course organization? How do you improve your clarity of presentation? So that is called low inference teaching behavior. That is a huge subject. You can read this book. I just sensitized to you. You can read this book and design an experiment for your institute to find out the attributes of good teaching. So they said the high inference teaching behavior clarity can be improved by these 8 practices. Out of 8, number 2, number 5, and number 6 are important. Give several examples of each concept. Not that important. Use concrete everyday example to explain is number one important factor for improving the clarity of presentation. Repeat difficult concepts several times. Trace important point by voice modulation. It's very important. So if you go to the class and you same pace you are reading a material, none of the students will be able to listen it. So your voice modulation, your repetition of difficult concept, use everyday example for explain difficult things, very much important to improve the clarity. Similarly, for course organization, they have to signal the transition from one topic to the next, put outline of lecture, explain how each topic fit into the course, give preliminary overview of the lectures. Similarly, teacher enthusiasm, move about the room while teaching, show inflection and variation in tone of voice, gesture with hand and arms, maintain eye contact with students. So for every high inference teaching behavior, there is a certain low inference teaching behavior. So those low inference teaching behavior has to practice by the teacher to improve the high inference teaching behavior. Then only you can improve your teaching. So your teaching feedback is not to collect that who is 3-pointer, who is 5-pointer. Teaching feedback is only how much you have done in the class. So there is attribute of good teaching, how much attribute you have covered in your class, how much attribute you have not covered in your class, that should be the feedback. Okay? I'll stop here and ask, open for discussion. Another 10 minutes.
Yes, sir. So participants can unmute themselves and then ask the question, or they can write even in the chat box.
There is a question, where is the role of the person with the teacher? Fascinate students on the subject. Fascinate students on the subject, I cannot understand. Can you ask orally? Radharaman Chaudhary, can you ask the question?
Yeah, good. This is Radharaman Chaudhary, sir. what I wanted to ask you is the teacher has a knack to fascinate a student on a particular subject.
Yes.
Is it true or, you know, all that we go by matrices?
Yes, because as a teacher, your responsibility about your subject only. So, if you are able to, if you are fascinated with the subject, means your enthusiasm on the subject is very high, that will be influx the students to achieve their goal. So only enthusiasm is not sufficient. You have to achieve the goal also. You have to define the goal also. That this much you have to achieve at least. So there is two things, trade-off. Fascination about the subject is very much required for a teacher. Unless you cannot good teach. Because one of the teaching, good teaching factor is enthusiasm in the subject area, which is nothing but a fascination about the subject. So if you are fascinated about the subject, you can able to motivate the student. Then only they can learn. So it is very good that you take care about one subject, another teacher take care of another subject. That is important.
Thanks. That's true, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Vyas?
Dr. Vyas, can you explain your query you posted in the chat box? I think he is not
able to. Any questions from any participant? Or, and again I will ask you, have you able to answer all the questions which I given to you? How will you have solved that evaluation sheet?
Ankit. Actually, sir, every day we are giving the assessment sheets and the response is collected.
So how many have any query on that evaluation sheet? So you have not understood the questions or you have a doubt on that questions?
So far we are going good, sir, on those questions.
Okay. And how many of you develop that course outcome in that portal?
Sir, I request you to. Hello, sir, I am audible?
Yes. Go ahead.
Sir, will you please share the information as many of the participants have asked me to regarding that particular portal? Yes, sir. Many of the participants have asked regarding
So I will share the slide. In the first slide, it is written that web address www.ide.iitkgp.ac.in. I'll show you.
Yes.
This is there in the first slide, beginning slide. www.ide.iitkgp.ac.in. Instead of earnet, you write ac.in. Or I can modify it.
Okay, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
And also what I say that in your Jodhpur, for your institute, what you can do, in whole institute you organize the program for once. As I have given that lecture, I will share you the PPT. You share it to all other faculty of your institute. And
yes,
ask them to develop their entire course.
Yes.
Then one day we can review your courses and that is sufficient for you to get the feedback.
Yes. Sure, sir. Sure.
Okay. And this attainment calculation also, because once you write down the outcome is correct, then attainment is very simple. And also that if you develop the entire course in the portal, it can act as a course file. If you see in the portal, there is a called download as a PDF. So entire course you can download as a PDF document.
Hmm. Yes.
That facility is there. So you can, once you download the entire course, a PDF document, that can be a course material for your course file. And yes, every changes in the portal. So when a feedback came, when you change something, that also will be recorded so that it can say that, okay, my course is updated every semester.
Yes.
Yes, sir. So, sir, I convey the thanks to all the participants, and I will, with your prior permission, I will share the PPT as well. Sir, I have already registered when you conducted a workshop in that, that is Dumka Engineering College.
Yes,
sir. That is a course that is the electrical drives and control.
Okay.
I have registered on this particular portal, and I assure you that our participant and we faculty members of Jeet Institute will also register on this particular portal.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Is there any questions to the lead?
Sir, thank you very much, sir. You.
No, sir. Thanks a lot. Yes, thanks a lot, sir.
All the sessions that you have conducted for us, they were on the part of practice. That first was how to write the proper course outcomes. Then second one was about how the attainment can be calculated, what the item analysis, how the item analysis can be done in the question paper, what kind of question questions can be set in a question paper. And then today final, how the course outcomes are mapped with the program outcomes, how the program outcomes can be assessed through the direct and indirect calculations. And last is about what are the attributes for a good teacher. So yes, sir, all the sessions were phenomenal, and all were very much related to the practical grounds.
Yeah.
All were very logical, and because for engineering faculty members, everything needs to be logical. So I really express my deep sense of gratitude to you, sir, on the behalf of everyone who has attended this course, who will be listening to these recordings, or who will be listening to your PPTs. So on all those behalf, I am expressing sincere thanks to you, sir, for sparing your valuable insights, time with us. And thank you. We would like to see you in our campus physically when all the situations.
So it is not possible, I think, up to December.
Yes. But whenever these situations would be normal, we would definitely be calling you at our campus. So thank you once again, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So, participants, the next session is at 1:30. So be sharp at 1:30, and after that, in the continuation, we would be having valedictory. So in the valedictory, we would be listening to you, because you have been listening to us since last 9 sessions. So it would be your session. So you are required to be present in this session, and you are requested to give your open feedbacks for the improvement of such programs in future. So thank you very much, and keep connected, and be at the session sharp at 1:30. Thank you.